I think I've probably met most of you already in this week now, but I have a brief thing about my background. Now, one thing I will say is I cannot see this on here. So if I keep turning around, it's to remind myself what to say, because I always have terrible trouble with my laptop and connecting it to things. But at least you can see this. So my background is that I have a PhD in remote sensing of coral reefs, which I finished maybe about 12 years ago. And I was based in a coral reef ecology research lab in the UK for quite a long time. And since then, I worked in some commercial companies. And as David said, now I'm an independent consultant, basically. And my interests are numerical modeling, particularly model inversion and uncertainty propagation. And in particular, applications in coral reef and seagrass mapping. Satellite-derived bathymetry is of great interest nowadays. There's a lot of people interested in that because certain parts of the world, or quite large parts of the world, have never been surveyed for bathymetry since the days of Captain Cook. And they can't afford to send boats to all these places to survey for bathymetry nowadays. So they're interested in, there's a lot of interest in using satellites to derive bathymetry. And also benthic photobiology. So I'm working with some collaborators on photobiology of corals and seagrasses. It's not really my, I'm not a photobiologist, but I know a little bit just from working with other people, but I'm primarily interested in the numerical modeling. And this picture here just shows I was lucky to work on a project, a World Bank funded project a few years ago, which was the coral reef targeted research project. I was in the remote sensing working group. And this is the boat in, we took an ACS and some other instrumentation around to various places around the world. It was very nice. And this is in Bolinao in the Philippines. And this is the boat we were operating the ACS off, which is quite nice. It's better than working in the North Sea anyway. And I will just say, however, you can see the ACS instrument just there. And normally, I did have it covered up because you don't want to have the instrument sitting in the hot sun all day. So I thought I'd just mention that. I just took it off for the photo. I don't want you getting bad habits from the very first slide that I show. So it was fun anyway. So, okay, so I've got three parts to my talk. The first part, I'm going to talk in general about three-dimensional radiative transfer modeling for shallow water applications. And then I have some, in that I'll talk about some of the consequences for remote sensing, and we'll look at some of that kind of stuff. And then in the second session, I'm going to talk about photobiology and submerged canopies, which is basically an extension of the same idea. How can you handle understanding the light interactions in seagrass canopies and coral reefs? And then I have a final section, which is a little bit different, but is connected, as you'll see, which is to do with sunken correction of high spatial resolution images. Now, Heidi Dearson has two lectures on shallow water remote sensing later in the week, so I'm trying consciously not to overlap with that too much, and this would be more applied to that actual shallow water remote sensing. So I may do a bit of that, but I don't know how long it's going to take me to do the first two sections, so if we don't have time, maybe Heidi will cover that. Okay. No, the question is whether anyone can actually see anything on this. So this is an example of the sort of imagery that I'm often working with. It's a high spatial resolution image. It's a Sentinel-2 image. So probably, I guess, a lot of you know about Sentinel-2. It's a fairly recently launched satellite, really targeted at land applications. But there's a lot of interest in applying it to marine applications in the coast because they don't image over open oceans. It has 10 meter pixels, so quite small. And this is an image of a coral reef in Palau in Micronesia. And so you can see the kind of things we have to deal with in this kind of situation. Like over, it's a bit dark actually, but over here the water's very deep. So over here you can probably treat the water effectively as of infinite depth. But over here you start to see the influence of the bottom reflectance. And then you start to see patches, and this is where you have different things on the bottom, sometimes darker, sometimes lighter. And then up here it's very shallow, but it's still underwater. And these are areas of high coral cover here. And then you've got a lagoon area. And what you can't see desperately well, or you perhaps can up here, because these pixels are only 10 meters, you get sun glint effects on the surface of the water at the scales of the waves. So it's different to your traditional ocean color satellite, which has very large pixels, where the glint just manifests as a kind of overall effect in each pixel. Here you can see individual wave fronts. So that's often a problem if we want to do any analysis on this image. It's going to be dominated by these glint effects unless we can remove them. So, for example, this is an area over coral. So this is a sandy bottom and coral. The dark patches are where you have fine coral. And this is what it looks like at the scale of the pixels. And each of these pixels is 10 meters by 10 meters. So within each pixel is very complicated. Yeah. It's not just a question of, well, coral reflectance or sand reflectance. I mean, even if you're using the highest spatial resolution sensors like you might, we're often using for these kind of applications, WorldView or Pleiad or QuickBird, where they have maybe 2 meter by 2 meter pixels, still within each pixel, it's a complicated structure and situation. You have vertical structures. If it's in shallow water, I mean, these vertical differences within one pixel can be equal to half or more than half of the actual depth of the water. Complicated structures like this. So, yeah, maybe I'll ask a question. Now, you remember when we were doing the hydrolite modeling, there was the one where we could put in a reflectance for the bottom, and you could choose sand reflectance or coral reflectance or something like that. Now, if you actually wanted to model a pixel like this, just in the simple terms, where you said, okay, it's not pure sand and it's not pure coral, but I've got a coral reflectance and I've got a sand reflectance, what would you put into hydrolite, do you think, to model that, a mixture? You'd put in the sand. If you've got a coral reflectance and a sand reflectance and you thought, okay, maybe it's 50% coral, 50% sand, could you do anything with those reflectances to mimic what you would think would be there within the pixel? If it's very bright, sand is very bright, coral is very dark, you've got a 50-50 mix, what do you think it looks like at the scale of 10 meters? Somewhere between the two, yeah? So this is what's normally done to handle complex bottom reflectance, yeah? Linear mixing. So the idea is that if you have sand, you have a reflectance of sand that looks like this, and you might have a reflectance of another type of thing, some kind of algae here, or coral, and you just add them in weighted sums. So for example, if it's sand, it's very bright, and you think it's 50% sand, so you times that by 0.5, and if it's 50% of this stuff, you times that by 0.5 and just add them together, and you get what's called a linear mix of the reflectance, that you can then say, okay, at a 10 meter scale, we think the reflectance is approximately this, because it's got small things in the pixel that have these different reflectances. And that works quite well if you assume that things are flat. So Kurt did a nice paper with Lydia Summan a few years ago, which showed that if you treat the bottom as a flat surface with different patches of reflectance, the scale of which is small compared to the pixel, then you're perfectly okay to treat that as a linear mix of the different reflectances. Just add them together in proportion, and it works out pretty well at the scale of the pixel. But the problem with that is it misses a lot of the things that you just saw in the images. There's no vertical structure, you don't have the effect of shadows, and if you're interested in the light interaction with the structures on the bottom for photobiology, you don't have that information. You're just treating it as totally flat. So, how can we do a better job of modeling the three-dimensional light field? Well, this is the problem that we have to solve. Light is coming from the sun. I mean, this is a sort of refresher on the concepts that we've been talking about. It refracts through the water surface, some of it reflects. In the water body, you have scattering and absorption. But then here, you've got complex structures on the bottom. So the light interacts with them in a way which we haven't considered before. It's not just a flat bottom. You can have interactions between different parts of the surfaces and so forth, and shadows and this kind of thing. And then the light, on its way back up, will absorb and scatter again and then transmit through the water surface. But this is also quite an important component, especially in shallow water environments and bright shallow water environments like coral reefs, is you have reflectance back down from the underside of the water surface. And obviously that goes back into the whole system. So I'll mention that again. So how can we go about solving this complex radiative transfer problem? Right, well, what we can do is Monte Carlo modeling. And Monte Carlo modeling, I guess some of you are familiar, probably many of you. It's a very nice way to do modeling because it's linked closely to the physics. And what you do is basically ray tracing with a statistical model or a probabilistic model. So you just shoot rays into the water computationally in the computer, and you make random decisions about when they should scatter and in which direction they should scatter based on your IOPs. So you put your IOPs in, and these things describe things like the probability distribution of how long the photon will travel before it has a scattering event or an absorption event. And the VSF, or the phase function, gives you the probabilistic scattering direction when that happens. And you can parameterize the surfaces in the same way, make them reflective and so forth. But the trouble with Monte Carlo modeling is this is very computationally intensive. So especially if you have a complicated structure like this, you have to shoot many rays in to get a good statistical picture of the light distribution. And every time you have a ray going through this complicated system, you have to decide when does it hit something. And if you have a strange structure like this in the model, in the computer, that's an expensive, computationally expensive operation to decide, well, does the ray hit this or is it going to hit this? And you have to do all those calculations every time. So it takes a long time. And the other thing is it undersamples certain areas. So basically, where most of the light goes, you get a statistically stable answer quite quickly, possibly. But if you're interested in light in the sort of dimmer areas, the less well illuminated areas, you have to put in millions and millions of rays before some of them come down here and fill out the light field down here. And that will also be very statistically unstable. So you might get a good, you repeat it with a different random seed, and you get a completely different answer down in these shaded parts because of the statistical error. So that doesn't work very well for this kind of problem. So this is a method that does work better, which is the one main one that I work on, which is a global illumination method. And the idea here is that you break down all of the surfaces and the water surface into small patches. And all of the space, the volumetric space where the water is, gets broken down into small cubes, voxels, like this. And so these actually fill the whole space. I haven't drawn all of them. You wouldn't be able to see anything. And what you do is you establish the radiative transfer relationship between every pair of elements. So you work out this patch here, for example, can potentially receive light from every other patch or every other element in the system. So potentially it can receive light from here, it can receive light from these and all of these. So you end up with a big matrix where basically it's like in this room, a point on the floor here essentially can receive light from every other point on every other surface that it can see, like this. So you work out that relationship and then you input light to the system at the top. So you have a model for the sky radiance distribution, something like that. The light gets transmitted through these water surface patches, which are special patches that embody the Fresnel equations. And then the light bounces around inside the system. It's like an iterative. It's basically like a successive orders of scattering model. So the first time you get the first order of scattering from every element to every other element. And then you update the amount of light that they've received. You update the amount of light coming off them. And then you iterate again and again until you converge to a solution. I'm going to have another slide. Okay. So now, if we have a sand reflectance and a coral reflectance, rather than just making a linear mix, we can actually map these reflectances onto the surface. So this structure here, which is meant to be a coral, would have a coral reflectance over its surface. And this would be sand. So you put the sand reflectance for all of the patches that are here. And similarly, you put your volumetric properties into the voxels. So each voxel has the volume scattering function and the absorption encoded in it. So you can have spatially variable properties of the water if you want. I don't ever do that in any of my modeling, but you could do it. You make them spatially variable at the scale that you subdivide down to. And the water surface patches at the top are special ones, as I said, they embody the Fresnel equations. So you've got the transmission and reflection viewing from both sides. So in other words, the light can come down and it can transmit through with refraction. It changes the angle and some reflects off. And then you have the same on the bottom. Light can come up and reflect down and it can transmit through. The way I've drawn it, it's like just you think, well, what happens to the light that comes off the side? Well, what happens to the light that should be coming from this side? Because it's a finite domain, yeah? Well, what you do is you make it periodic. So basically, the whole setup sees itself in all directions and in these directions as well. So it's kind of like pseudo-plane parallel. you've got a certain structure and you just repeat it and repeat it infinitely in all directions, and then you don't have this problem of like the boundary conditions. Okay. So, I'll just take a drink. This is how it works. This is the hardest bit. It's not that hard, but so I have to explain this, otherwise you won't understand the figure later on. So in hydrolyte, we have a directional discretization, and you'll have seen this in Kurt's lecture, and you'll have a sense of this, that we take all directions that can be represented by a sphere, and we decompose it like this. Well, we do the same in this model, because we're decomposing not only spatially into patches, but also directions. We need a directional discretization. And it's very similar to this, but it just looks a bit different. It looks like this, and it's based on the idea of a cube with squares on it, and then you can map that onto a sphere, and it kind of looks like this. So it's subtly different to this one, but this is a very convenient form for computation. This is why we do it this way. But we want to know the directional light onto patches. So unlike hydrolite, where that sphere is fixed and you just move it up and down through the water column, when we have individual patches, we put this onto the surface of the patch at whatever angle it is. Because the idea is that a patch, a surface patch, receives light from the whole hemisphere that it can see, basically. See, you see what I mean? So that is how we do it. We put it on here. Now, imagine we have a patch and we want to know how it receives light from two other patches or from patches that are around it. We want to know how much light is this receiving from here and here. So we have this directional discretization on the surface of the patch, and we just project the patches into this here, like this. And basically it's the solid angle. So what you're looking at here is what is the solid angle subtended by this patch in relation to this point on this patch. Because if you're near to something that's very bright, say, and you're very near to it, it's from your perspective, it subtends a very large solid angle. So you receive a lot of light energy from that. Whereas if it's far away, it subtends a small solid angle, so you don't receive so much light from it. And this is the key thing that we have to determine, is what is the solid angle subtended by the different patches from the point of view of the patch that we want to know what light's it getting. So this is like this, which is really like this, because the structure is like a cube. And then we can unfold it like this. So this is a representation of what this patch sees here. And these represent the solid angles subtended by these other patches. Now, the reason I show this is, one, because I'm about to show you some other figures that look like this, so you understand what it is. It's basically a representation of the hemispherical view of a point on a surface. But also, when it's in this form, it's very easy to compute on a computer, because basically what you're doing is drawing what can be seen at quite low resolution, the way I show it here. And computers these days are very good at drawing three-dimensional images. I mean, you know from video games and all this kind of stuff that they have dedicated hardware for drawing a three-dimensional scene. So one of the good things about this method is you can leverage that computational power of the computer. So basically, simply, all we do is we take every point in the scene and we say, what can it see? And we just draw a 3D image that shows what it can see, and we work out how the light comes from that, and we just iterate over and over again. Right. I shall show you an example, become very clear. So imagine this is an example run of the model. Very simple, two sort of dome-shaped coral structures here with a water surface, a slightly undulating water surface, which I just put in. It's not a like proper statistically correct water surface, but I just put it in to demonstrate. We have a model of the sky radiance distribution that comes down onto the top of the water surface like this. That's going to be transmitted through, and this is just like a hemispherical view of the sky, show what it looks like, a bright sun in a blue sky. And then this point here, this is what this patch just here sees in the model. It sees this structures like this, and it's a bit distorted because it's like a fisheye kind of view. Yeah. So now I'll show you what actually happens inside the model when you run it from the point of view of that patch. So First of all, there's no light, so it sees nothing.
Yeah.
Can you just go back one? I have a question just to orient.
Yeah.
So is the big thing above, is that the underside of the surface?
Yep.
No,
on
it's
the left.
On the right.
View from the patch, I mean the right.
This?
Yes. So is
this is the view of this patch here.
Right. So when you see that.
That's the underside of the water here.
That's the underside of the water surface.
Yeah.
That's the underside of the water surface. Here are these, because it's repetitive, yeah? So the whole scene is over here and over here. So it sees itself, in a sense, in the distance. And this is just a bit of a weird angle because of the patch, yeah? Good. Any other questions before I carry on? Don't want to, like, confuse everybody or anything like that. Right. So at the start, we haven't run the model yet. So there's no light in the model. The first thing that happens is the light that's incident on the top of the water surface is transmitted through the water surface patches. And it goes through them one at a time. So basically it'll fill in. This is the transmission on the underside of the water surface. It works faster, and I've slowed it down I don't have to wait this long for a solution normally. It's just for effect. So all we see now is the underside of the water surface. There's the sun transmitted through the water surface. And these dark areas here, where there's no light, they're areas of total internal reflection, where later on, all you'll see is the light reflected up and down from below the water surface. There's no transmission because the angle is such that there's no transmission. So the next thing that happens is the volumetric elements, the voxels that embody the water scattering, will pick up light that has now been transmitted. So it's the first order scattering of the volumetric components. So you see that they now, I say emit light, they're not emitting light, they're scattering light basically. But you see the light, that component of the light. And so we haven't processed any of the surface patches yet, but we can see the shapes that are there because the path length from our viewpoint, or the viewpoint of this particular patch, you know, the longer the path length, the more scattering is picked up on that path length. So things that are in the distance look hazy. I mean, it's from normal experience, yeah? And then when you have things that are close, they look very dark because it's only a short path length and there hasn't been very much scattering. So then we fill in the surfaces. Right, so now basically everything's first order scattering. So we've got the transmission through the air water interface, we've got the first order scattering in the volumetric voxels, and we've got the first order reflection from on the surface patches. And the main thing to notice is some of these patches here are still very dark, and that's because they haven't received any light yet, because they don't get any light directly. The only light these will get will come from the reflection of the sand around them, because they're facing down onto that. So the next one is we process the water surface patches again, and now this fills in the total internal reflection from the first order scattering that we had already. So all those black areas get filled in with light that's basically reflected off the bottom. And then we just process the rest of the, we do another processing pass on the volumetric scattering, so now we've got second order scattering in the volumes. And you see, it's quite a bit. It makes this brighter. It gets brighter again, yeah? It's like the second order is, you know, the biggest component is the first order, but the second order is not insignificant. And then we get another pass on the water surface again. And so then we would just do that a few times and get a number of iterations until we converge to a solution. Right. So, converge to a solution. Do we think it will converge to a solution, or will the light just bounce forever? Anybody have an opinion? If I did 10 iterations, and I did 100 iterations, would it eventually stabilize to a solution, or would it just be, the light would just go up and up and up and up forever? Anybody think of a reason why it will converge to a solution? Exactly, yeah. As long as there's some absorption in the system, eventually some of the light will get sucked out, and it's basically like dampening the system. So if there was no absorption, if you modeled a white room with 100% reflective walls and 100% scattering medium in it, you would end up with basically a white fog in a white room. It would just look white. And then and convergence then would be difficult because the phones would just bounce around forever. But as long as you've got some sink in the system, either some absorption, but also with the model, the light that's transmitted up out of the water surface doesn't come back down again. So that's another, basically photons that go that way never come back. So there's always some sinks in the system that mean convergence is pretty much guaranteed, as long as you get the math right, which for many months I didn't. But I shall prove now, well, I shall try and prove or demonstrate that it is right now. Because basically you can put the model into a plane parallel configuration and compare it to hydrolite. So in that case, all the volume, the cubic volume, just becomes layers because it's a plane parallel configuration. We take all the structures out, but we use the same solution method. So I just have an example here of an optical depth of 1, single scattering albedo. Who remembers what that means? Single scattering albedo?
Gotta wait 12 seconds. It's common sense.
Go ahead.
It's a fraction of flux scattering against flux scattering and absorption. It's like the amount of photons that survive after.
Yeah, probability of photon survival. It's scattering. It's the ratio of it's B divided by C. So basically, what it says is a photon is traveling through the water, say. Something happens to it. It either gets absorbed or it gets scattered. If the single scattering albedo is 1, it always gets scattered. There's no absorption. And conversely, if it's 0, it always gets absorbed, never gets scattered. So a single scattering albedo of 1 is a very strong test for something like this, because it means that there's a very high... the photons, it, certainly in the water volume, will just scatter all the time. They won't get absorbed, but they get absorbed in other places. So, for example, I put a surface... the bottom reflectance is 70%. So that is also very reflective by natural materials. You know, you could probably get a very bright coral sand that might be 70% reflective. That's pretty high, yeah. Petzold's phase function and 10 layers. So if I run the model like that, the question is how many iterations are required to get to convergence? And actually, this is a general thing about successive order of scattering models, ones where you iterate to add in the successive orders of scattering. So it's a general interest. And here we have these bars are the results from hydrolite. So this is, I'm just looking at the radiance. It's actually something like the radiance incident on the bottom of the water column at an angle of 60 degrees, which is just, I mean, I could look at anything, but that's one that takes a while to converge. And what you see is that if you have a low single scattering albedo, it converges very quickly because of the absorption. Dampens the system, essentially. If you've got a single scattering albedo of 1, it does take quite a long time to get there, but it does get there in the end, and it does level off. So I had a slide that had like a load of equations and stuff in it, but I decided not to show it. So, but basically, the key is in the way you treat the volumetric scattering. These kind of methods of... they use them in computer graphics and this kind of stuff, but they don't do it the right way. And if you do it the way they do it, when you do this kind of a plot, either the line doesn't make it up to where it should do, or actually more often, it just goes up and up and up and up and up like this. So you have to do the careful math about how to deal with the volumetric scattering. And you know, like I'm satisfied with the performance now. There was a time when I wasn't, but.
You can put any IOP in any phase function you want, any one of those little cubes.
Yeah. Indeed, yeah, so you can look at volumetric patchiness and this kind of stuff in terms of the optical properties of the water, yeah. Any questions? I'm going to be careful not to go too fast and, yeah.
Why is it faster treating this as a successive order of scattering than Monte Carlo? What makes it faster?
Because what you're doing is... okay, there's two aspects to it. One is if you're interested in light that might be dim in shaded areas, so this type of thing. This, the way that I'm doing it here is everything gets processed equally. So on every pass in the model, you consider the light transmission between every patch and every other patch. And that means to say everything gets treated equally. Now in a Monte Carlo model, you have to wait a long time before any photons get to those places that aren't very well lit, illuminated, yeah? So this one has a more like equal treatment of places that are bright and places that are dark. So overall, you get a, if it's the way it's a global illumination method, you get a solution for the full light field in three dimensions quite efficiently. So if you use a Monte Carlo method, like Monte Carlo methods are better, like for example, if you're interested in just you've got a sensor pointing down and you've got the sun here, and you want to know what does this sensor see? Well, you don't need to necessarily know the light field in all these other directions. So you can use a backwards Monte Carlo, where you send the rays backwards from the sensor, and then you see where they end up in the sky eventually, and you work out what the sensor's seeing. But I'm interested in global illumination, partly for the photobiology applications, which you'll see later. But also, it means you get a full solution, and once you've got a full solution, you can do anything with it. So that's kind of the main reason, yeah.
John, would it be correct to say that when you set up your geometry, you kind of do a one-time calculation that figures out where each little voxel or each little surface pixel, what it can see and what it can't see? You only have to do that once, and then you sort of iterate on that. Whereas with Monte Carlo, every photon starts from scratch. You just have to trace it and see where it goes.
Yeah, well, that is, I used to do it that way. You're right, because actually that is the way that I used to do it. So you have this thing called a form factor, which is actually exactly what Kurt says. You can work out the relationship between a pair of patches, and then that's fixed because they have that relationship. But actually now with the GPUs, it's easier to just crunch the numbers, and I don't bother, I just do it. But that was how I used to do it, like that, yeah.
I think my question was similar, sort of, you were talking about how you've got the branching structures and the repeating structures, but and it's sort of infinite, but I mean, the absolute irradiance at the time is going to determine, you know, how far the interactions actually stretch. So do you just set an area, or is that dependent on what the, in terms of how many...
Do you mean in terms of how many repeats of the scene?
Yeah.
So in theory, you could do it infinitely, but I don't, because it's you can't really do it infinitely. So I would have that's the thing, which is like a parameter which I set, and then make sure it's enough, basically. And you can always do it, like, for example, depends on the geometry of the system. You might have like five repeats or something. So the same scene is repeated five times into the distance. And by then, the thing is, because you've got absorption anyway, the path length from you to the end of the system is such that there's no light coming from there anymore anyway, because they would be all absorbed, you know what I mean? So in a sense, you become isolated from the distance anyway, so you don't need to do it infinitely. Okay. Right, so I'll show now a couple of runs, and this is to show the sort of applied or the consequences of that you can see when you have a model like this. And I showed two example runs. One has these dome structures like this, so it's like a certain types of coral are like this. I mean, if you guys know about corals, you get like these kind of massive corals that have dome-like structures. And then you have branching corals that have these kind of branching structures. And I can put sensors anywhere in the model because it's a global illumination solution. So once you have a solution, you can put a virtual sensor in the model somewhere. And I got these things that are like cameras that look and make an image. And then I have these ones here that are like pixels. So this is like, this could be one pixel in a high resolution remote sensing image. And it's basically like an orthographic projection. It just looks at the radiance coming directly up over this area. And then these are the two sky models that I'm having in these two separate. So one has the sun in a relatively high position and one in a lower position. And what I've done in the next sort of slide is I animate the sea surface. So there's basically, I run the model 16 times or something with the sea surface being adjusted slightly each time to make an animation, a sort of dynamic animation. So this is what you see when you're like inside the model, basically. And you can see some of the things that are captured, like obviously shading, which is one of the things I talked about before. the total internal reflection on the underside of the water surface. And also wave focusing effects you see here. But I would say this is not the best model for wave focusing, or actually this is quite an old animation. I think I could do better now, but the problem is, for do wave focusing really right, you have to have a very high spatial resolution and a very high angular resolution, yeah? And so these are a bit blurred out, like really these should be thin lines, yeah? And you can do it actually, but nowadays, I think because the computers are better, it can probably do a better job, but okay. And then because it's a global illumination solution, I can make a view from any direction. So this is just one point in time, and we turn around and you can see, for example, you know, in which direction does scattering predominantly happen with a real phase function, like Petzold's phase function? Forward, exactly. So you see here, when you come round to look towards the sun view, the sun is shining towards you here, you see how much more scattering there is in the water when you look there. And what's interesting actually is you see in the, I think you can make it out here, when you look into the distance, when you're in the opposite direction, the water is in some way colored by the color of the corals, yeah? Because you've got reflections off the corals and reflections off the underside of the water surface, this kind of brownie color. And you see that scattered in the model as well. Like it's kind of a slight tinge of that color there. And then for the branching ones, it's the same kind of thing. I have, you see the shadows, it's different because they're branching structures. And you can see the resolution here that the model's at. I used to be one time that I would smooth this out, but then, you know, you lose something because you don't understand what is the actual inherent resolution of the model. So I always leave it looking patchy and stuff.
Sorry.
Yeah.
How you create these shapes? Is it always the same shapes? You have one shape for domes and one shape for branches, or is it random?
In this one, nowadays I can do it randomly. I think I can't remember exactly what I did for this, but they would have been I would have had a random thing and I would have made the shapes in some way. But it's one of the problems is like you've got to, you know, it's like I'm just making things more complicated, yeah? Because it used to be all we needed to know was like the phase function, or well, that's easy, not the, you know, this stuff. Now you've got to know the structures as well. You know, so sorry about that, guys. You know, it gives you something to do, huh? So now this is, okay, so remote sensing perspective. If we're looking down on the top of the scene, but this is just below the water surface. So this is, I have a sensor just below the surface of the water, so we don't see the surface of the water in this. We can see, so before I talked about this idea that, okay, if you said it was 50% coral and 50% sand, you take a coral reflectance, you take a sand reflectance, you add them together, and that would give you a good estimate maybe of the reflectance you actually wanted to use. But you can see there's other stuff going on. There's shadows, wave focusing is maybe important here, I don't know, this kind of stuff. So if we integrate, the model's hyperspectral, so I can run it in whatever bands I want. So I have, this is in 17 wavelength bands. So I can make a spectral plot here. So this is upward radiance divided by, it's just upward radiance, so it's not the reflectance. Okay, it doesn't matter. So it's the upward radiance integrated over this. So this is what your remote sensing instrument would see, you know, without the water surface or without the atmosphere. And you can see the spectra here, and you see how it moves up and down a bit because of the wave focusing effects. Now, this solid line here is what you would get if you use the linear mixing model that I talked about before. So if you just took the area of this and the area here and said, okay, let's weight the coral reflectance by this area and let's weight the sand reflectance by this area, this is the reflectance you would have. And okay, so here it's a bit brighter than it should be because of the shadows. In reality, there's shadows. But with the branching corals, it's much worse because there's many more shadows in this branching structure, yeah? So this would be your estimate if you used a simple linear mixing model. But actually, it's like this, it's much darker. So now it's above the water surface, so, and we can do the same thing. Now, this jumping up and down here primarily is to do with these white patches, which is sun glint. It's when the facets of the surface turn towards the sun and you see the bright sun reflectance. And you see how big a difference that makes there. Now, anybody spot the deliberate error? I don't want to know about the errors that weren't deliberate. What did I say about the sun positions? I showed you initially the two models, and I said this is the sky input for one and this is the sky input for the other. Were they the same? No, I had the sun low down in one and the sun high up in the other. But look at the pattern of the glint. It looks pretty much the same in both, yeah? That's because I stuffed up. This is the wrong animation, yeah? Yeah, I don't know what happened to the right one. I did these ages ago. There should have been a different animation here, and you would have seen the glint would be in different positions because the sun position is different, yeah? So I ran a bunch of different models, and these ones have the same sky input. I think the ones I showed before were right, but these ones are wrong. So you see the sun glint patches there. It's the same in both because of the same sky radiance. But okay.
Sorry.
Yeah.
Yeah, and the color of the coral, are you using always the same color? Or
for these models, yes. But we have, I mean, there's a lot of people making special reflectance measurements of corals, and we have access to, I mean, actually some of this stuff is you can get it online on, is it Pangea, the website where people put data sets. A guy called Chris Rolsomer and Stuart Finn of the University of Queensland have many, many reflectance spectra of corals, which they've taken underwater with a spectroradiometer. And you can get all that data. So it's easy to put variation for reflectance of corals and stuff. This is the end of the first section. So any questions?
Johnny, you try changing the turbidity of the water column in different ways to see how those images are affected, and when you, the point where you lose contrast, this would be an amazing model to apply to visibility.
Some time ago, I did put in different IOPs and stuff, and I had one that was really cloudy and like yellowy, and you could hardly see the corals and stuff like that. But I haven't done anything like that recently. But you can do that.
I suppose sometimes they are mixed up corals, like brown branches.
Yes.
How do you manage to?
Well, you can put them in together. You see what I showed you with the branching. You could just put a round one and a branching one together in the same scene. Or this is, I mean, I think now I have to, I haven't done anything with this for a while, and the computers now are much more powerful, and I think I can do much more, actually even better than this now. And so, but I haven't really investigated that stuff. I mean, you'll see in my next slides, what's happened is interesting. I found more applications for seagrasses than I have for corals with this stuff, because it's hard to find people who have data on coral structures of sufficient detail to put into this. But if for seagrasses, you can find people have morphometrics of canopies, leaf lengths, all this kind of stuff. So I've done more work on seagrasses using this model than I have for corals. So you'll see that in a minute. Yeah.
So when you watch a movie by Pixar, Finding Nemo, are you just looking for all of the errors?
Kind of. You know, I mean, I'm always really impressed with that stuff, you know. But what I think is, you know, like Kurt said in his talk at Ocean Offshore, I'm pretty sure it doesn't obey conservation of energy, you know. So it's just, I'm pretty,
It's like politics. It's what looks good that matters, not the truth.
Accurate.
But could you use this to improve video games?
Well, people ask this. Probably not. I don't know, because I think that the needs are different, yeah? So in the video game arena, they know how to do things that look good, and they just want it to look good. And, you know, I mean, my methods are still probably too computationally, you know, they want it to be fast. It has to be really fast for those guys, you know. I think that they have their own agenda. And there was probably a time where there would have been an overlap, but I think that now that they just go off in their own way to make things look good and don't really care about people like me. I don't know. I always thought it'd be good. I really wanted to go to the SIGGRAPH conference. The big conference for this stuff is SIGGRAPH, and that's where a lot of the ideas that I use come from the papers that were presented there in the like late 80s and this kind of stuff. And I often thought I'd be good to take it back to that, but I've got a feeling that they're not interested, so I don't know. Okay, so I'll move to the second bit. I'm pretty sure that I won't get to do the third bit, but that's okay because I think Heidi will do it, this stuff. So it's another application. As I'm moving on to photobiology now. So I was lucky when I worked on the World Bank project that I was in a remote sensing working group, and there was a working group on photobiology, coral photobiology, but it also included people who work on seagrasses, and I had a good interaction with them. And from that, I got into working on questions of things to do with photobiology within the canopy. The light propagation into the canopy is really important for those guys, because the trouble is they don't really know what's happening. So with corals, I mean, this you guys probably know, but I always make this point that corals are photosynthetic organisms. They have a symbiotic dinoflagellate that lives inside their tissues, and they need light to survive. And that's the thing that distinguishes reef-building corals from cold-water corals, is this symbiont. The energy that they get from this symbiont is what enables them to calcify and maintain the reef. So it's very important, the light interactions for those. They need light and so on. Same with seagrasses, obviously they're photosynthetic. So now the important point is, often you read a paper about seagrasses or something like this, and they talk about the light of do the seagrasses have enough light, or they do some measurements with a PAR sensor or something like this at the bottom of the water column. But what they know then is the kind of thing you'd get from hydrolite, which is the downward irradiance on the top of the canopy. Now, what I'm going to try and convince you in the next slide is it's not enough just to know the downward irradiance on the top of the canopy. You've got to understand how the light propagates into the canopy to the photosynthetic tissues, because that's the important thing. And what you'll find is that people understand very well, or that they work a lot on the tissue level photosynthetic response. So you people working on things like photosynthesis irradiance curves and this type of stuff, which I'll show in a minute, at the level of the leaf of a seagrass. And then they have the irradiance at the top of the canopy, but there's a gap there, because the irradiance of the top of the canopy is not what the leaf experiences. It might be, look, if there's a bit of leaf at the top of the canopy, probably is, but within the canopy, no. And it's the same with corals. They have complicated structures. It's not really enough just to say what's the plane irradiance on the top of the colony, because it's getting light from the side, and it has branches and shading inside it. So this is basically the arena that I work in when I'm working with photobiologists. And I've got two examples. The first one is to do with corals, and then this is a short one, and then I have something about seagrass. So you guys know about coral bleaching and stuff, probably. You know about it. If corals get too warm, they expel these symbionts that live within inside them, and they turn white. And it's a bad situation for the corals. Often they might die afterwards. Sometimes they can be recolonized by the symbionts and they recover, but it's a bad stress situation for them. And it's known that it's a response to elevated temperature. So if the temperatures are, it's a big climate change problem, obviously. If temperatures are elevated for a long period, then this is when you start to get bleaching. But the actual mechanism of it, most people believe now, is to do with the light, the processing of light. So basically, a coral is a photosynthetic organism. Well, the symbionts are photosynthetic. They have photosynthetic machinery, and when it's illuminated, that machinery is working flat out, yeah? It's processing photons and, you know, like crazy. And obviously, it's susceptible to damage. It gets damaged, it needs repair, and this kind of stuff. And what people think is that the elevated temperatures affect the ability of the photosynthetic machinery to repair itself. So actually, the cause of the damage, in a sense, is light, because it's the light that they're processing in their sort of molecular biology kind of photosynthetic way, and they have to maintain that system. So there's been a few studies now that look at basically the interaction of temperature and light on photosynthesis in corals, and whether it induces bleaching if you have too much light. There was quite a famous, well-received paper by my former supervisor, Peter Mumby, where they questioned why the corals in a certain place didn't bleach when they should have done, because the temperature was elevated and other corals were bleaching, and they figured out it was because it was cloudy. So because it was cloudy, it cut down the light. The temperature was still high, but the cutting down of the light protected the corals to some extent. So there's a very interesting paper that came out by a guy called Ortiz in 2009 in coral reefs, where he was looking at bleaching, and he suggested, and it was kind of anecdotal really, it wasn't the main finding, that corals, he had observed that corals that were surrounded by a bright sand substrate were more likely to bleach than corals that were surrounded by a sort of dead rubble with a bit of turf algae in this sort of darker surround. So this is just an example of, I just did a simple little test just to illustrate the significance of this in terms of light. And it's another one. We did some CT scanning of coral skeletons. So we have actual skeletons to put in, skeleton structures, coral structures to put into the model from this CT scanning we did. So that's where this one came from. So this is the coral. It's surrounded by either sand or rubble. And this, at this point on the side of the coral here, this is the difference in the light that it receives, the spectral light it's receiving, E. So it's irradiance on the patch, on the surface, orientated this way. And this is when it's surrounded by sand, and this is when it's surrounded by rubble. So you can see that there is a difference there. And that's maybe where you would expect it, because it's facing out towards the sand. It sees the sand. That patch sees bright sand all around it, so it receives more light. Now, if you look at a patch right inside the branching structure here, there's a slight difference, but it's not so much, because that patch there sees other parts of the coral around it more than the sand. So the solid angle subtended by the sand is smaller than that surrounding the surrounding branches. But here's the interesting one. There's a question. I'm going to ask a question now. So a patch that's on the top that's facing straight up can't see the sand at all. But look, it still makes quite a big difference, yeah? Whether it's surrounded by sand or darker rubble. Why?
Reflection.
The total
internal.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, the total internal. It's good, isn't it? Yeah. Excellent. Oh. Yeah. So you must. Yeah. Basically, you can see the underside of the water surface, and the underside of the water surface is reflecting all the sand. Yeah. So actually, it's interesting, and this is quite an important thing, especially in coral reef environments, because the sands can be very bright. So, you know, if you ever go diving, you go underwater, it's really bright, yeah, because of this constant reflection. The water traps the light in some sense because of this internal reflection. So it can be a very bright environment, and it's obviously quite dependent on the nature of the bottom, and if that's reflective, it's going to enhance the light more. Okay, so seagrasses. Why are seagrasses important? It's good to start with a slide explaining that, I find, just, you know. So seagrasses are ubiquitous. They're found on every continent apart from Antarctica. You can find them here. If you've been swimming on the beach out here, you only have to go a few feet and there's quite dense seagrass. They're very important as part of the blue carbon budget. This is of a great interest to many people, particularly species like Thalassia, which you find in the Caribbean, this tropical species. It has big rhizomes, extensive rhizomes under the sand, which store carbon, basically. And some guy did a paper, Forcurian, I think. And he said, he came to the calculation that The seagrass beds could store as much carbon as a forest, or something like that, per unit area, which some people debate. I should put a balance on that. But nevertheless, they're generally considered important carbon storage, you know, important environments for carbon storage. And also, they've been recently shown to calcify. So Thalassia will calcify. It's calcium carbonate particles come out of it, basically. It calcifies in there. And that's even more important because it's inorganic carbon. So inorganic carbon is less readily released, again, than the sort of stuff that would be in the rhizomes, yeah. So they're important sinks for carbon. They're important indicators of environmental change. So if you have a situation, they're often near coral reefs, and if there's a change in the conditions of the water, you see it in the seagrasses before you see it in the reef, because they respond more rapidly. And they're also very important in being associated to coral reefs because, for example, they're nursery habitats for reef fish. So reef fish are important for grazing down the algae on the coral reef, so more corals can settle and grow, and the reef doesn't become overgrown with algae. Those fish, when they're juveniles, live in the seagrasses. So if you don't have the seagrasses, then you lose those fish, and it's bad for the reef. So they're important environments for many reasons. And so a lot of interest in remote sensing of seagrasses and photobiology, understanding the response of seagrasses to light, changes in the optical properties of the water, especially in places where you have like dredging and stuff, like in Western Australia, they have these kind of dredgings for new ports. It puts a lot of sediments into the water and they're supposed to not kill the seagrasses. So they're kind of interested to know whether they're going to kill the seagrasses or not and when they have to stop doing the dredging and this kind of stuff. So now, this I'm going to mention, leaf area index. It's an important descriptor of the canopy density, if you guys, maybe some of you don't know. So I just explain, the leaf area index is simply the area of leaf to the area on the substrate. So it's an indication of the canopy density. So if you have a high leaf area index, you've got a lot of leaf area compared to the actual area that covers on the substrate. Leaf area index is one of the main descriptors of a canopy, but there's many others that are important. You know, the leaf lengths, the positions of the leaves, if they're all standing up or if they're all lying down, that kind of thing. The reflectance of the sand that surrounds them, whether the leaves have any epiphytes on them. If you go to the beach here and you go for a swim and you grab some of the seagrass and pull it up, you'll find that basically you can hardly even see the seagrass leaf, especially at the ends of the leaves. They're absolutely covered in a pink calcifying algae. And on top of the pink calcifying algae, you've got little brown turf algae stuff as well. And the leaf is underneath that stuff. So these epiphytes are important for the light absorption at the leaf level. Dead parts of the leaf, all sorts of things are important in understanding the interaction of light with the canopy. That said, I shall now ignore most of those. Well, we'll see, I tell you. So this is some work that I've done with Susanna Enriquez. And she's a seagrass photobiologist, and she has lots of data, all this kind of data that you need to do this kind of modeling. This is the sites that she's worked on in Puerto Morales in Mexico. It's just south of Cancun. And they have a lagoon there with thalassia in it, predominantly thalassia, and all different kind of areas of different leaf area indexes. So this is the data which we had. Shoot density, number of shoots per meter squared, the length of the leaves and the distribution of the lengths of the leaves. You know, have you got a lot of short leaves or have you got less long leaves, that kind of thing. Canopy height, so that's the actual, it gives an indication of how bent over the leaves are. Optical properties along the leaf length, I shall describe those in a minute. Photosynthesis irradiance curves, I shall also mention. And underground biomass, that was for another study, I don't need to mention that here. Oh, and the leaf area indexes vary from 0.5 to 4.7 across these sites, and they're in depths of 0.5 meters to 4 meters. Right, so this is the model that I'm using here. Now, this part is the 3D model. The thing about a seagrass canopy is it's a complicated structure at the bottom of a water column that's not so complicated, usually. So there's no point in trying to model the whole thing in the three-dimensional model. You put a lot of effort into modeling the water column then in three dimensions, but you don't really need to because you can just look at the canopy reflectance. You can put the 3D model here, and on the top you can have a model basically like hydrolite that is just a water column model based on the IOPs. You could use hydrolite there to do that component. So really I'm talking about the light response of the canopy from the point of the top of the canopy, yeah. And so I have this model that I can put in an atmospheric model and then it gets propagated through the water column. And then I have the three-dimensional model at the bottom. And this, we published this model. So, and I'm using this for lots of things now, this coupled model for remote sensing and for photobiology. Now, the leaf of the thalassia. Now, idealized thalassia leaf. This is what one leaf of the seagrass is like. basically, you have so they grow from the bottom. So this is the oldest end of the leaf. It's a grass. So the meristem is at the bottom, and the end of the leaf is the oldest part, and this is the youngest part. So what's happening is it's growing in this direction, and it matures as it grows. So the absorptance of the leaf is highest kind of around about this point. And then this is where you have the certain photosynthetic response. I mean, it's all photosynthetic here, but it's kind of maturing, so it changes along the leaf length. And we have this here, which is the par absorbance as a function of leaf length. And you see it goes up, and then it goes down as you get towards the end of the leaf. And then often you have a brown, dead part at the end. That's the senesced part of the leaf. And this is the bit that eventually kind of snaps off or breaks off. And there's no photosynthesis in this part, but there will be in these parts. So we made this model for, you know, a generic model for a Thalassia leaf, so we could extend the leaves, make them longer and shorter, but they all follow this same pattern, as you can see from the data. This is from data, this plot. So we have a model for the optical properties of the leaf. Now, unlike corals, seagrasses are, can move, yeah? They can be in different positions and so forth. And my concern when doing this work was that some reviewer goes, oh, yeah, well, that's all very good, but, you know, what if the canopy's in a different position? You know, doesn't the, you know, if it's standing upright or if the leaves are folded over, that's all going to be different and everything. And so in order to head that off, I built in a model to animate, to move the canopies according to a simple wave model. So it's just a simple model of wave physics, which you find in any textbook, where basically as a wave comes over, you know, you have this circular motion, and as you come down in the water column, it becomes more elongate, and then at the bottom, you just have this moving backwards and forwards. And so I set up this model that has basically forces that obey this movement, and then I model the leaves as flexible strips, and I just push them with this force, yeah? So basically, I can do this kind of thing and make the canopies move. Now, sometimes I show this and people go, oh, right, great, like, I work on, you know, wave dynamics and canopy interactions, and that looks really good. And I have to say, well, you know, it's not really physically correct. You know, you can't really work out the forces and the drag because it's totally unvalidated and everything. My purpose was simply to have something that makes the canopies in different positions. So from an optical point of view, you know, a reviewer can't sort of complain that I didn't think about that. But also it makes a good slide, yeah. So, so always a consideration. So, oh, you'll see. I have. You'll see. You'll see something. No, not really. I mean, is the short answer. So, I have an animation. So, this is from the actual model. So, I've run the model. Oh, and the only other thing I've mentioned here, just for clarity, we don't need to go back far. The other thing that I don't do when I'm running the three-dimensional model with the seagrasses is I don't bother to try and do the scattering between the leaves, because basically, you know, it's such a short path length between the leaves, and the scattering, as you know, of the water column, the water, I'm talking about the water scattering, is so peaked in the forward direction, you know, that if I said, okay, what's the light coming off this leaf here that's incident on that, there's really no point in implementing a volume scattering function there over that tiny path length, because basically all of the light is still just going to be going forward. So I only do the absorption, and I just assume any scattering continues in the forward direction within the canopy, because otherwise this computationally is, you could probably do it, but there's no point. So this is the result from the model. So these are, it's, as I say, I've just got the canopy structure in the 3D model, and I'm irradiating it with light from above, which would be what you'd have at the bottom of a water column. I mean, we have, we know the KD values for the sites we were working on. So I put in some IOPs that are reasonable to give the right KD. And this is at a depth of 0.5 meters. This canopy's leaf area index of 4.5. And this is a leaf area index of 1, sparser canopy, a depth of 1.5 meters. So you can see, you know, the shadows and how the light interacts with the canopy as it's in different positions and this kind of stuff. This is quite nice. So validation, can't be bothered with that. No, I do. We do it. So what? Now this is interesting. This is an interesting concept for you guys, maybe, because what quite a few people do who work on seagrasses is they extend the concept of a diffuse attenuation like KD into the canopy. So what they've done here, what Susanna did is she had an irradiance sensor and she took it down through the canopy, taking measurements of light in the canopy and coming up with a KD figure for a number for attenuation within the canopy. And we can do the same in the model by having a virtual sensor that we take down to look at the KD. So it's like this, I mean, a bit like this. This is like a fisheye view, but it would be what the sensor would kind of see as you move it up and down in the canopy. And then I can make a plot like this of the light. So this is it's above the canopy, you pull it down, and the light goes down, obviously, because it's covered by leaves. Now, you see how noisy it is? Like, when noisy, jumpy, jumping about? Because I think this is possibly one of the few, I don't know, like, in the model, it's, like, more noisy than it is in real life, probably. Because in the model, it's a virtual sensor. So it can come down the canopy, it can literally pass through a leaf. So you can have a thing where it just literally passes through it, and you go suddenly from a situation where it's got a lot of light to one where it doesn't have very much. Whereas if you did it in real life with a real sensor and you pull it down, that's not going to happen. Yeah, it probably pushes the leaves out of the way a bit. So it's just probably the only time I can think maybe where you have a model that's more noisy than real data. Yeah, but nevertheless, it's what I have to work with. So I try to fit curves to them, but I've done it many, many times. So these are just examples. So we do it over and over again, hoping to average out the noise. And so we've got a sparse canopy and a more dense one. And actually, we did get quite good validation. So these are the KDs that Susanna measured versus what I had in the model, KD for par. So you can see it's not too bad. That one's a bit bad, but basically we do capture the trends. So that's one validation. I don't think there's the other one. I have done other validation exercises. I don't think I have the slides for it. Often we're looking at the reflectance above the canopy as well as one that we have. If we have data for that, we can look at that. Okay, I'll briefly mention this. I think Heidi will talk about BRDFs, but you guys know, I think, what a BRDF is anyway. But it's very interesting with this. I just draw attention to this particular thing because it's well known, and it's the hotspot effect. And so basically, if you have the light illuminated from a certain position, and this is what we can do with the model, illuminate from different positions and look at the reflectance as a function of the angle that you look at the canopy. And what you find is that when you look from the same angle that you illuminate from, it looks a lot brighter. And this is a well-known thing from terrestrial remote sensing, forestry and this kind of thing, this hotspot effect. And it's a little bit like the thing that Mike talked about, the constructive backscatter, where the beta 180 stuff. But in this case, it's purely in geometric optics. You don't need to think about Maxwell's equations or anything. It's simply because when you look, if you've got the light coming in from the same direction that you're looking, you've got minimum shadows. You don't see the shadows. So that's where you get this effect, that as you come over and at the point when you're in line with the incident light, you see the least shadows in the canopy and it gets brighter like this. So it's an important thing. And I think Heidi will talk more about that maybe. Okay, so given that we have a model for the canopy, this is what I'm getting to, is we can start to look at where does the light go. So this is looking at, we've got the reflectance of the canopy. What isn't reflected is absorbed. It's absorbed by something below the top of the canopy. Where is it absorbed? These are six different canopies of different leaf area indexes. This is the one that has a high leaf area index. And you can do like a budget for the energy breakdown of where is it absorbed. And so the green part of the leaf, the photosynthetic part of the leaf, is absorbing this much of the light. The sand underneath the canopy is absorbing this much. The brown parts of the leaf, the end bits that are senesced and not photosynthetic, they absorb this much. The water itself within the canopy absorbs that amount there. And then the gray part is the component that's reflected. So you can do an energy budget of the canopy and work out how much is being absorbed by the different structural components, essentially. And so under the movement of the canopy, does that change? So this is the energy budget as the canopy is moving like this, yeah, as I showed. And with a very dense canopy, right, there's no key, but the two lines that you see there that go like this, that's the leaf, the green leaf absorbed component versus the sand absorbed component. And you see how they go like this, and it's because as the canopy comes up straight like that, at a certain point the sun, the incident light, directional incident light, is largely incident on the sand, and then as soon as it bends over, it's all incident on the leaves. So you see this kind of movement does affect the energy budget, does affect the reflectance. So you were asking, does it make much difference? It has a small effect, more on a dense canopy, not so much on a sparser canopy, but it depends on the morphology of the canopy. Okay, another interesting concept. Par absorption as a function of leaf area index. Okay, gonna ask a question, just thinking what it is. Right, if you have a canopy of a certain leaf, if you make a canopy denser and denser and denser, I don't know how to ask it in the right way. If you make a canopy very, is it always advantageous to make a canopy more dense? Anybody, like, so you've got a certain canopy, you can put more and more leaves in it. Is that always a good idea? When does it stop being a good idea? From the
position?
Shadows, yeah, self-shading. I mean, basically, there's no point to, at a certain point, you absorb as much light as you can. The canopy is, it can't really absorb any more. The limit is really the reflectance of a single leaf. So if you have, you know, at the top of the canopy, you've got a leaf like this, and it's going to reflect a certain amount, and that stuff that it reflects straight up can never get back down into the canopy. So there's a limit there, and it's not going to be 100%. It can't absorb 100% of the light. If you plot the absorption of par as a function of leaf area index, you get a curve like this. I think you get a curve. I mean, it's debatable. It's certainly not a one-to-one line, which is this. You know, it's here, and it's coming up like this, and it will eventually asymptote at a certain point, and then that's the point where there's no point to add any more leaf area index, because you're already absorbing as much light as you can, and all you do is add more leaves that can't, they're not going to get any more light. The canopy as a functional unit, it becomes less efficient. And if you extend that asymptote from the modelling, it's, you know, round about leaf area index 12 is the maximum. Now, Thalassia doesn't get to leaf area index 12. It's at the highest 4, 5, maybe 6 in some places. But there are seagrasses that do go up to about a leaf area index of 12. So it's an interesting, I mean, there's no real, like, it doesn't prove anything, but it's interesting to see that. That is kind of similar to what you get from the model. Right. Okay, so the last bit, probably. What time is it? Oh, no. Yeah, probably. Okay. Photosynthesis irradiance curve. I guess you guys are familiar with this. Some of you guys will be familiar. It's been mentioned a few times already in the lectures. This describes the response of the leaf to increasing irradiance in terms of the photosynthetic activity. It's not stuff that I do myself, but I know basically the idea, which is you take segments of a leaf, and this is what Susanna does. You put it in an oxygen electrode equipment, and you irradiate it with increasing amounts of light, and you see the photosynthetic activity, you assess it in terms of the amount, the oxygen evolution, yeah? And you find this kind of thing, which I think we've already seen this plot today or earlier, which is basically you've got a linear phase where as you increase the light more and more, you know, if you double the light, you double the photosynthesis. But at a certain point, it levels out when you reach the saturating irradiance, and then you don't get any more photosynthetic activity as you increase the light. And in fact, if you go far enough, you start to get into photo inhibition or photo damage. Now, the important point about this is it's at the level of the leaf, yeah? So the way you get this stuff is you take a piece of leaf and you put it in this equipment and you irradiate it. And it's also very non-linear. So what that means to say is really to understand at the scale of the canopy what happens in terms of the photosynthetic response. You can't just look at the irradiance of the top of the canopy because you don't really know how much of the canopy, how much of the leaves are in this linear phase or how much of them are in the saturated phase, yeah? It's going to have a very non-linear response. So it's not enough to just say, oh, the canopy is getting a certain irradiance, you know, so that's going to be enough or it's not going to be enough. You don't really understand how it propagates into the leaves. And if you don't understand that, you don't really know where you are on this curve. So I can demonstrate this. So basically, what we can do with the model, we know the light incident at every point on every leaf, so we can map it onto this curve. And we have a plot like this now, where the red parts are where you're in the saturated part, and the blue parts are where you're still on the linear slope, yeah? So you see the leaf tips are saturated in this dense canopy. The leaf tips are saturated, but the within the canopy where it's shaded, you're still in the linear phase. And this is for, you know, typical, this for the actual canopies that we modeled, which were this leaf area index 4.5 here, depth 0.5 meter. This one's deeper, and it's a sparser canopy. So it's in deeper water, so there's less light, effectively. But because it's a sparser canopy, the leaves are generally more in the saturated phase, a part of the curve, than this one, or animation. So, and you can also see how it varies a little bit, especially in this canopy with the position of the canopy. Because at a certain point, when the canopy opens up, when you're coming up like this, and the light's coming from above, you get an increase in the light. It's the sort of minimum shading point, and the light increases inside the canopy, and these get up closer to the saturation.
But are they able to respond so fast to changes of light?
No, they don't actually respond. Yeah, they are. There's, exactly, yes, I think so, yes. It's the instantaneous. It's basically an instantaneous response to photosynthesis on this curve. So, yeah, in my understanding. At least Susanna never said anything different, so I assume that's correct. Yeah. So this is basically the important point, and it's the point that I try to make when I make this presentation, is that you have to know there's a gap, like I said before, between the light that's incident at the top of a canopy and the leaf level, the tissue level response. And actually, that's something that not many people look to bridge, and we should do more work to bridge this gap, yeah, to really understand these things. And ultimately, what you end up with is a thing like this, and this was from a paper that I published with Peter Ferns and Catherine McMahon from Curtin and ECU in WA. Basically, it was to do with, it's a different species, it's Amphibolus, another seagrass species. And it was the context was dredging. So the idea was, if you shade a canopy, what happens? How does that affect the light environment of the canopy and the photosynthetic response? And what we did just by modeling is show that you have this kind of a plot where there's a trade-off between the leaf area index and the shading. Because if you shade a canopy and it starts to die back and thin out, it thins out, and then the individual leaves start to get more light. So basically, there's a kind of contour lines. We have this kind of idea of contour lines where if you've got a canopy that's at leaf area index 4 and you shade it 20%, well, that canopy can basically start dying back and it's thin out until the point of where it's getting the same, at the leaf level, it's getting the same light than it would have done without the 20% shading. So you can move along these contour lines like this, yeah? So it's quite important, because what you often can read in the literature and what people say is, there was a change in the water quality, the light went down, and we took measurements of the leaf area index of the canopy, and the seagrasses are all dying. Their leaf area index is getting less, they're thinning out. It's like the end for the seagrasses. But it might not be the end for the seagrasses, because it could simply be interpreted as an acclimatory response. Basically, the grasses could be thinning out until they get to the point where they can survive a certain level of light. Or maybe not, because if you go all the way over here, then you do die. So it's a question of understanding the interaction of the canopy and the light levels, rather than just saying, oh, the light went down, the canopy's thinning out, so it's all over, because it isn't necessarily. Any questions on that? Yeah.
I'm curious as to how, when you're modeling the seagrass, it looks like an infinitely thin, double-sided pixel.
Yeah.
So
The leaves are modeled as notionally infinitely thin surfaces, but they transmit as well as reflect. So it's like a patch, like I talked about patches before, but it has a reflectance on each side and it has a transmittance as well. So light incident on one side is transmitted through and the other way. But notionally, within the computer, they have no thickness. Yeah.
So just to add on to that, so that creates noise in that one figure that you showed, just because of that reduced.
To do with the thickness, or to do with the way that the fact that they're notionally infinitely thin doesn't really make any difference to anything, because they would only be very thin anyway in terms of the model. But the noise, the trouble is in a model, if you put a virtual sensor in it, it can just pass through a leaf because I don't physically model a sensor. It's not like you could do this, of course, but it's too hard. You know, I don't physically model a sensor that pushes the leaves out of the way. It's like a virtual sensor. It's there, but it has no effect physically on the canopy. So you just pull it through, and you do that. It can pass from one side of a leaf to another like it's a ghost, you know, like it's invisible. So then you suddenly get less light because you just pass through a leaf, yeah. Hi.
Question is about the carbon fixation by the leaf.
Yeah.
Because even if you look at the PI curve,
yeah,
you can have, for instance, an average light over a day, mm-hmm, or you can have an average because it varies a lot.
Yeah.
Or you can have an average because it varies a little around that average, right? And what is more important to the to the growth of the leaf or carbon fixation by the leaf? If you consider the instantaneous variation in light, mm-hmm, and you consider carbon fixation as a function of this light?
Well, presumably you would integrate it over time, I imagine. You could integrate the photosynthetic activity over time. So, you know, wherever you are on that curve, you're there for a certain period of time and you add that up over the day, I think. Does that make sense? Yeah.
You have to be a little bit careful because the curve that you showed, which showed photoinhibition, means that the leaf that was exposed was not currently photoinhibited because it was able to be dampened at high light. But once it has been photoinhibited and it has been exposed to high light for a long time, the whole Pmax gets lowered down to that level. And so then if you did a PI curve, you wouldn't see the damping at the end because it already has been damped. And so you have to sort of, this is amazing model because it allows you to calculate the total amount of time that each pixel on the leaf is exposed to supersaturated irradiances, so you could actually use it to model where on the leaf and what time each pixel becomes photoinhibited.
Yeah.
As you can do a much better job in terms of being able to estimate the total primary production because you actually have each pixel on the leaf.
Yeah.
And I suspect that's part of the reason, in addition to the end of the leaf being old, that it turns brown, it's also getting much more photoinhibited with time.
It's also possibly a shading response because it's possibly good for the canopy, yeah? Because you've got those brown bits on the end of the leaf that are just, yes, exactly, yeah.
No, the eelgrass isn't stupid, I'm sure. It's doing it for a reason.
Colin, or anyone, what's the time scale? If I'm a Thalassia syra leaf and I get blasted with the light, so I'm supersaturated for, you know, a tenth of a second. What's the time scale to recover when the light goes down so I go back on the curve to where I'm happy? Is that?
Well, the instantaneous flashes that's immediately recoverable.
Okay.
It's the part where the saturation occurs as you start to get damage to the photosystem. It's the same thing with phytoplankton. And I was just saying before, that John Cullen and Pat Neal did a nice study for phytoplankton in the Antarctic, looking at the relationship between mixing and the intensity of light. And so for phytoplankton in the surface waters under high light, if they're held there because you have a stable water column, they can get damaged to the point where they actually die. But if there's enough mixing so that there's time for recovery, so that the rate of saturation versus the rate of recovery is in balance, then you just see a reduction in photosynthesis, but no permanent damage. And so I'm assuming it's the same here.
Yeah.
So when I was looking at his two models, the one that was on the right-hand side was in saturation almost the whole mm-hmm. leaf was in saturation the whole time, whereas in the longer canopy, it's much quicker. And so there's probably a likelihood of acclimation. And so there's people who have done a lot of kinetic works on that. But if it's just quick in recovery, you know, dark light, they can respond and repair. It's when it's this, constant.
Yeah, and would I be right in saying, and Colin, you know more about this than me, but there's a bunch, you were talking about the non-photochemical quenching type mechanisms. There's a bunch of different mechanisms, isn't there? And they have their own time kind of periods and all this kind of stuff. Yeah. Okay, anybody else? Yes, Mike.
You showed that you used a two-system model for the canopies where the IOP's coming down and then that kind of incident on.
Yeah.
So is that valid because just the reflectance from the canopy is relatively low compared to...
Yeah, yeah, like, you know, I see what you're saying, because to do it properly, really, you need to have the reflectance coming back up and coming back down.
Right.
And at a certain point, I did do some tests and concluded that I didn't need to worry about that. But this couldn't be done. You can do it because you could do it in two stages, which you model the canopy, and then you put that reflectance... I mean, I put a reflectance in for a canopy, but it's not quite the right one, you know, it's like an average kind of one. But you could do it in two stages where you model the canopy reflectance, plug that into hydrolite, then get the downwind irradiance from that and then put it back in to the model. So, but I generally don't bother to do that. I haven't done it anyway. Yeah.
Another question that's just curious.
Yeah.
I know nothing about seagrass. So,
yeah.
In terms of nutrients, does the seagrass take the nutrients from the sand?
It's through the leaf, I think, in the water, yeah. I mean, some of them don't really have... The Thalassia has these rhizomes and so forth, this extensive root system, but a lot of them don't have such extensive root systems at all, so I think they can take it through the leaf. Yeah. Okay. Anybody else? No? I think, well, I didn't have the time to talk about the sunglint stuff, but I think maybe Heidi will do that, so it'll be all right. So that's enough for now. Okay, thanks.